Ladies and gentlemen, the call will start exactly at 12 noon. If you are participating in the call, I would ask that you assure that you are muted on entry to the call. We'll start momentarily. Thank you. Okay, again, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be starting at noon promptly. If you are just coming into the call, please assure that you are muted. We'll be back momentarily. Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Robert DeFore. I'm the district superintendent and the chief executive officer of Sullivan BOCES. This is the third and final in a series of parent and community stakeholder Zoom meetings that we are conducting with regards to Sullivan BOCES reopening plans. I'd ask that if you are not muted, that you please mute yourself. There will be a short presentation, and then we will have time for questions at the conclusion of the presentation. I would ask that if you have a question that you would like to ask, you enter your name only into the chat feature. We will be monitoring the chat and calling on each individual as they appear in the chat feature. With that, I'm going to ask, do a quick introduction around the screen. Joining me on this call is Natasha Shea, Assistant Superintendent for Instructional Programming, Jennifer DeFrank, Director of Human Resources, Maria Summer, Director of Curriculum and Instructional Support Services, Adam Real, Executive Principal, Secondary Programming, Megan Becker, Executive Principal, Elementary Programming. Natasha, am I missing anyone? Okay, so at this time, Natasha, I'm gonna ask you please to share your screen. And we will walk through a short slide presentation on Sullivan BOCES reopening plans, and we'll take questions at the conclusion of the presentation. Okay, so recent developments. On August 7th, the governor announced that school districts in New York State could reopen under the plans that they submitted in September, providing that the region that they were attached to, and Sullivan BOCES, Sullivan County, is part of the Mid-Hudson region, that if their infection rate for COVID-19 was at or below 5%. The Mid-Hudson region has hovered between 0.6% and 1.3%, has not gone above 1.3%. The governor also stipulated at that time that within 2 weeks of his announcement and by August 21st, a series of meetings needed to be held either in person or virtually to include faculty, staff, parents, and community stakeholders so they had an opportunity to view the plan and to ask any questions that they may have. There was also a countywide Zoom with the Sullivan County Public Health Department and all of the administrators from all of the school districts in Sullivan County on August 12th to discuss reopening procedures and in particular to discuss COVID-19 testing and contact tracing. On Friday, August 14th, Public Health sent a packet of information on COVID-19 testing and contact tracing to all of the school districts in the county. And the school districts are using that documentation as guidance in their reopening plans. The full packet of information is available on the Sullivan BOCES website. Next slide. So Sullivan BOCES used something called the Technology of Participation Framework during the planning for their reopening. The planning for reopening for Sullivan BOCES began back in May and proceeded throughout the months of May, June, July, and culminated at the beginning of August. The health and safety of our students and staff was the number one priority during all of the planning discussions. The proposal to begin the school year by transitioning from a training and acclimation period to a hybrid model to ultimately full in-person instruction. The decision for students to attend face-to-face or remote is ultimately a parental decision. Sullivan BOCES will be offering full remote instruction in addition to opening in a hybrid modality. A survey was sent to all of the parents of our 600 registered students asking whether they would send their child back in a hybrid manner or elect remote instruction. That survey closed out on Tuesday and over 350 parents responded to the survey. Those parents that did not respond are presently being contacted individually by phone to make a determination as to whether or not their child will return face-to-face in a hybrid manner. Next slide, please. So why consider a hybrid model? Opening in a hybrid model will give BOCES staff the opportunity to implement our new safety practices and procedures with 50% capacity of students. Give us the opportunity to train students on new procedures, assess social and emotional, as well as academic needs, and adjust procedures if necessary with limited impact on the students. The reduced number will help us to see what needs to be adjusted with a more manageable population size and allow us the time to train and acclimate students and staff to this new reality. Hybrid model considerations. First and foremost, health and safety. Safety protocols and procedures. Screening process. PPE, personal protection equipment. Increased cleaning frequency based on CDC guidelines. Staff training will be conducted on September 2nd, 8th, and 9th. Student training will be ongoing. Cleaning protocols. All New York State Department of Health and CDC cleaning guidance will be followed. Daily cleaning and disinfecting will take place following all relevant guidelines. Utilization of door hangers for staff to communicate with cleaning staff will be done. Staff training for cleaners and others. No use of disinfectant in the presence of students. No personal cleaning products in buildings. Cleaning protocols. Frequent cleaning throughout the day of high-touch surfaces. High-touch surfaces include door handles, push bars, light switches, handrails, faucet handles, toilet store door locks, towel dispensers, bathroom doors, and fixtures. We're going to do our best to eliminate common shared items as well. So daily student and staff screening process. A remote screening tool has been developed that will be utilized by staff and students prior to coming to work or prior to coming to school. The tool is available by hyperlink, QR link, or paper copy. Parents are asked to complete the form the morning before they send their child to school. The screening tool includes the four standard COVID-19 questions as stipulated by the New York State Department of Health. On arrival at school, as students disembark the bus, they will have their temperature taken. A temperature of 100 degrees or greater could cause the student to be sent back to the district. If a student is sent back to the district because they're showing a temperature, parents and the districts will be notified. PPE equipment will be available if students or staff do not have their own and when needed for intervention. It is anticipated that masks will be required to be worn by all students, faculty, and staff at all times except for mask breaks. This is what the screening tool looks like. Students' first and last name, the day the student is going to school. If you're filling it out the night before, you would choose the following morning and check that appropriate box, the campus to where your child is assigned. And then the four COVID-19 questions. Does your child feel feverish or have any symptoms known to be associated with COVID-19 in the past 14 days, including a temperature of 100 degrees Fahrenheit or greater? Has your child had contact with anyone confirmed or suspected to have COVID-19 within the last 14 days? Has your child been under quarantine and not cleared to return to school? Has your child traveled to a state covered by the COVID-19 travel advisory? And on that question, there is a link to the New York State website, which is the most current up-to-date list of those states covered by the travel advisory. Answer to all of these questions is what's desired. If you answer no to all of these, you will get the screen on the left telling you your child is permitted to come to school, and we ask that at the conclusion you hit submit. If you answer yes to any of those questions, you will get the screen on the right, which will tell you not to send your child to school and to contact the building principal. And again, we ask you to hit submit. Ladies and gentlemen, if your child is not feeling well, please keep them home. If your child is complaining of not feeling well, please keep them home. We're looking to protect all of our students, faculty, and staff, and only by working together can we accomplish this. If you send your child to school sick, he will be sent back home. So, hybrid model considerations for instruction. Flexible scheduling and a design that incorporates blend of in-person and remote learning, curriculum instruction, the power standards, work-based learning and lab hours, related services, both virtual and in-person, therapeutic interventions, protocols are currently in development, social-emotional learning, multi-tiered support systems. The next slide, Natasha. Proposed opening timeline. There will be conference days or professional development days set aside for the faculty and staff on September 2nd, 8th, and 9th. There will be an acclimation and setup time period on September 10th and 11th. to get individual classrooms ready by their teacher. The hybrid schedule for students begins September 14th. Full reopening target date will be determined based on continuous monitoring of local conditions. We will not even consider reopening full-time face-to-face unless the data supports that decision. So this is a review of the district's plans for reopening. All districts are proposing to reopen in some type of a hybrid model. Eldred will be opening for students on September 28th. Until September 28th, they will be starting out remotely and they are working on an alternating week hybrid model. Fallsburg, Liberty, Monticello, Sullivan West, Tri-Valley are all working on an AA remote BB hybrid model. Roscoe and Livingston Manor are working on an AA BB remote hybrid model. All districts have committed to get their kids to BOCES, regardless of the program, if BOCES is open for that programming, whether they're fully face-to-face or not. This will show you a breakdown of our projected enrollments by program. The most important number is that in blue at the bottom of each column. Our goal is by opening in a hybrid model to reduce that figure by 50% or more to maximize social distancing. So these are the results of the survey that we put together. Maria, do you want to go through those slides for me since you're here?
Sure. So overall, you know, we asked the question, will you send your child to school if classes are held in a hybrid environment? And for all of our K-12 special education students, you can see that 60% of the students or 60% of the respondents said that they would come to school face-to-face, and 40% said that they would be attending remotely. For our alternative education students, it was about the same. 56.5% will be in the hybrid model, and 43.5% will be remote. Career and technical education, 74% of our students said that they would be coming to school in the hybrid model to do their hands-on work that they do in their shops and labs. And 26% said that they would be working remotely. The question, does your child have access at home to a computer or Chromebook, some kind of device to participate in remote learning? 68% of our students said yes. 31% of our students said no. And the pink is they didn't respond either way. Does your child have access at home to high-speed, reliable internet to participate in remote learning? 92% of the respondents to the survey said yes, they do have access to internet. 6.7% said no, and the pink again is they did not respond.
So, Natasha, would you pick it up from here, please?
Sure. So we're preparing to reopen in a hybrid model. Part of that work included coordinating schedules with component school districts to make sure that our cohorts are in sync with each other. We're working to keep siblings in the same cohorts to help out with parents and also for transportation purposes. And we also want to use this time during the hybrid model to assess the transition between in-person and remote learning. So students will be coming in a few days a week and then transitioning to remote learning and back and forth if they're in the hybrid model. So part of what's going to happen during our hybrid and remote learning models during the remote days are the teachers will be going over instructional practices. They're be meeting with classrooms, still do classroom meetings, to take attendance and do check-ins. especially with assessing students' social emotional well-being, which is called SEL, social emotional learning. We're also going to be holding throughout the days individual or small group conferencing to get more one-on-one time with students to assess their individual needs, and also allow time for student independent work. So it's not going to be on those remote days, all on the computer all day long. We're going to carve out time to make sure students have support and they're able to work independently on their own. And also our related services. There's going to be some flexibility for what services are held in person on the day students are in person. And also some of the services may still be conducted remote. We're also going to carve out some time to have office hours for parents if they need to contact their teachers, or for students to contact teachers via email, or if they want to set up a meeting time to have any sort of discussions. So our cohort model is going to coordinate with most of our component districts. Our cohort A will be here on Monday, Tuesday in person, and they will be remote Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, as you see in the chart. And our cohort B students who chose hybrid will be coming in, or will be at home remote on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and coming face-to-face for services on Thursday and Friday. And that's for our special ed, alt ed, and our K-12 programs. For our CTE, it's going to look a little different. We divided our programs into cohort A and B. So if you chose a certain program for your student through CTE, we're assigning that program to either a cohort A or cohort B. And we are coordinating with the component school districts to make sure that's communicated and corresponding to the days that they're able to come in. So our principals and guidance have already been working with the component school district principals and guidance to make sure they know what cohorts our programs are assigned to. We are making sure that our CTE schedules are still in alignment for the days that they're coming in. So our AM program begins at 8 a.m. to 10:35. And our PM program starts at 11:45 a.m. till 2:10 p.m. And that's for the in-person. Even during remote instruction, we're making sure that time's carved out so students can do their remote assignments if they're on remote days, Monday through Friday. And the focus of the in-person instruction in our hybrid model will be focused on the lab work and work-based learning requirements for those programs.
So in summary, BOCES is committed to ensuring the health and safety of our students, faculty, and staff. BOCES will comply with New York State DOH and New York State Education Department requirements for reopening schools. Collaboration with all stakeholders is key to a successful reopening. Ongoing and consistent communication with all stakeholders will be critical. Continuous monitoring of operational functions will also be required. Staffing availability, PPE quantity, students' attendance, et cetera. At this time, folks, we'll take any questions that you have. Again, if you would just enter your name in the chat feature, we'll call on you one at a time. Just as some additional information, within the next 5 days, letters will be going home to all parents informing them of what cohort their child has been assigned to, what their anticipated schedule will be, including the link and the QR code for the remote screening tool, and a copy of the FAQ that was developed, which is currently posted on our website, so parents have it at their fingertips. Our principals and Ms. Shea are available to answer any individual questions you may have. If we do not have an answer to your question, we will certainly get back to you within 24 to 48 hours with an answer to the question. So if any of you have anything specific you'd like to ask, please. Okay, AK, are you there? You want to unmute yourself, LAK, or do you want me to just answer the question? So LAK asked, what are the safety measures on buses? BOCES does not provide busing. Busing is provided by each individual component school district. Their protocols could vary district to district. Some districts own their own buses, others contract with different bus companies. That is why part of our protocol is to take the temperature of the child as they get off the buses. We do, however, operate several shuttles in between our campuses, and we will be following the CDC and DOH guidelines and protocols to assure that our buses are clean and sanitized during use. A. Hanold, I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name. Would you like to ask your question, or would you just like me to read it? That's a good question. Can my child who attends Fallsburg decide to only attend BOCES in person and do remote learning at his home school district? That, sir or ma'am, you need to really bring up with Fallsburg. I only have jurisdiction over Sullivan BOCES, and we are offering either a hybrid or a remote model for all of our students. But that particular question, you really need to bring back to the Fallsburg School District. I would suggest that I'm assuming because it's a split schedule, I would suggest calling the high school principal or the guidance counselor to ask that specific question. You're welcome. Anybody have any other questions? Folks, my email is on the website, so is Ms. Shays, as well as the rest of the staff that's on this call. This is the third call, and we've basically followed the same format. If you have any concerns, if you have any questions, please reach out to us. How will the students in second year cosmetology get their hours in? We anticipate that with the cooperation of the State Education Department and the schedule that we're putting together, as well as a hope that we will ultimately be back together full-time face-to-face within the next couple of months, that the hours will be able to get in. If there winds up being a concern with that, as time goes on and we're still operating in a hybrid format, we will need to address that, possibly bringing in students more days per week. But initially, we believe that we'll be able to get the hours in. Does that answer your question? You're welcome. Folks, any other questions? What is to be done if a child's sibling is sick and you don't send them? Can they do remote learning that day? It's supposed to be a day they are supposed to be in school. The answer to your question is yes. If you're not sending your child because you feel they're sick or a sibling is sick, or, you know, reality, you may wake up one morning and your circumstances change. Remote instruction will be available. You'll have the links provided to you by your teacher. Yes, we encourage you to be safe. Keep the child home. Have them participate remotely, but I would also encourage you, please call the principal so that they're aware that there may be a change in circumstances. On that flip side, some of you are deciding to start remotely with your child. If you decide after a period of time that it's safe for your child to come in and you want them to participate in a hybrid scheduling, please don't just put them on the bus. Call the principal first, because we're balancing the cohorts out. And it could take us a couple of days, maybe a week or more, to assign kids to proper cohorts to keep that balance. No, the remote instruction is not anticipated to be in real time. How will that look at this time, not being able to? We actually are able to do clinicals in the medical facilities. The question has to do with the CNA program, though our instructional suite at Catskill Regional Medical Center has been co-opted as a COVID-19 ward, and we've been advised by the hospital that we need to keep that space, or they need to keep that space at least through December. We have leased additional space at SUNY Sullivan so that we can hold our Health Doc 1, Health Doc 2, New Visions, and Allied Health programs at SUNY Sullivan. But the hospital has committed to work with us to still provide the clinical rounds in a safe environment. Should parents provide hand sanitizer, or the school will have that available on campus? We would encourage you not to send your kids on the bus with hand sanitizer. Hand sanitizer happens to be very flammable, and the Department of Transportation has indicated having it on the bus is a bit dangerous. We will be encouraging our students to wash their hands with soap and water, It is the single most effective way to prevent the spread of the virus. But in those areas where water and hand washing may not be available, hand sanitizer will be provided. But not every child is going to be given their own bottle. Provisions will be made for it around our campuses. Any other questions? Going once, twice. Folks, if you have questions after this call is concluded, please contact us immediately and we will do our best to answer those questions. If we do not have an answer, we'll get back to you within a reasonable amount of time. So I thank each and every one of you for participating in this call. BOCES staff, thank you for making the time to assist me with this presentation. This presentation has been recorded. All of the recordings will be up on our website. Several of them are there now. This one should be up by Monday afternoon. Again, if you have any questions, please reach out to us. Folks, thank you for joining us and have a very pleasant day and enjoy your weekend.